Head. So, if your head's not pointy yet, you can join me in the pencil sharpener. I am suffering for Jesus wearing a suit, right? You know that. We had a marvelous time in Arizona, and I can tell you that the Lord was just right on, spot on. He's the one that made the arrangements for us to be able to go down there, free place to stay. Never once got in the pool. And he told me before we went, he said, it's going to be 108. No, I said, it's going to be 108 down there, Lord. And he said, yeah, even 110. But that's why I'm sending you, so you'll spend time indoors and you can be with me. I don't want you to do anything, so we did nothing. We excelled at doing nothing. We took joy in doing nothing. And we just had an amazing time. Every morning, you know, we would be spending time with the Lord, and at night before we go to bed, I just, oh my goodness, the Lord just spoke to me in volumes, and of course spoke to Jackie in volumes, and we even spoke to each other. The Lord was right there in the midst of it. So got a few things to share about that once we get started. It is a thrill to be back, a thrill. I sorely missed you. We did get to John and Marguerite. We missed them by 3 days. They go to the mountains for the summer because they get out of the heat. You go up to the mountains and they have a place to stay, and where it's cool. It's, you know, 20, 30 degrees cooler where they're at. Probably harder to breathe because it's high elevation. But we were in Scottsdale, and John and Marguerite live in Tucson. So I was trying to make arrangements to run down and spend a little time with them. And the Lord spoke to me and just said, hey, you know, why don't you renew that relationship that you had with Richard? Richard Castile is the pastor of Grace Chapel there in Scottsdale. He and his wife, Becky, and 38 years ago, I used to play golf with Richard. He was on staff there at Grace Chapel in Tucson. And he remembered me. And matter of fact, I think the last time Jackie and I saw him was probably about 18 years ago. It was at a Foursquare conference, a worldwide conference that they had in Dallas, and we were there, and I ran into him, and so we got all excited and spent the afternoon together and evening together and went out to eat and all that stuff and really fellowshipped. And here's the thing, I got to share, it was right after I first had the dream about the Lord saying, come up here. I shared that with him, and his mouth fell open. He didn't know what to do. That, oh my goodness. Oh my goodness. This is the first time I've seen him since then. And I remember then the Lord giving me the dream about coming up here. And what? How do you break fellowship with everybody you know? How do you walk off and leave your family? How do you walk out of a life of 20 years? How do you leave your loved ones and We're a small body, but we're knit together. Our hearts are knit together. I bleed when you bleed. I cry when you cry. I long for deeper relationships with each one of you. And spent much time in prayer when I was away for each one of you here, crying out to God that we could grow in Him, crying out that, Lord, would you show us what's next? Would you give us new revelation? Would you lead us? And we had that kind of relationship after 20 years of walking with people in the Metroplex. And when the Lord said, leave that, we didn't know how, but He made the arrangements. And I can tell you, I was kind of raised in the desert Southwest when I was a kid and lived all over it, always the desert Southwest. Only one time, and it was a very short time, was I in heaven. Well, two times. One was in Big Bear Lake, California. It's up in the mountains. Love pine trees, love mountains. And the second time was in Sholo. Lived in Sholo for a little while. Lived in Phoenix for a little while. Lived in Tucson for a little while. I just lived all over that desert Southwest area, and I just really, really, really love it. And when the Lord told us that we need to come up here, do you know what my response was? Oh, God, I hate rain. Oh, God. Now, that's one reason I knew it was God. There's lots of people who want to move up here because it's beautiful. They find out it's beautiful, but they move for the wrong reason. I knew when the Lord said, oh, that's where I want to build it. That's where I was supposed to go. And so, I don't know if you know it or not, but This is a mission. We are missionaries. The Lord sent us here. And I think rightfully so. Of all places I've been in the United States, other than Key West, Florida, Washington's in more need of the presence of the Lord than any state I've been in. Average age of hearing of Christ for the first time is 42 in the state of Washington. If you filled every church to capacity three times over and did three services in the state of Washington, only hold 0.5% of the population. 0.5% of the population. I may get my facts and figures a little bit mixed up, but they're close. Anyway, I've complained to the Lord. I said, but Lord, they don't care about you. He said, I could have sent you to a place where they don't understand your language. You're right, Lord, this is great. So God's on the move. He is changing us. He's transforming us. He's bringing us revelation. He's setting his path. He is. How many of you have changed since you've been coming here? Now look around. Raise your hand. Look around. God's changing us. God's changing us. And he's conforming us to his image, and he's preparing us for something. He's preparing us for something. Have you ever wondered what that something is? Well, I hope today to get over into that area of something. It's his blessings, it's his presence, it's his fellowship. It's to be able to walk and hear his voice, feel his spirit, to catch a revelation of him where our spiritual eyes open and the reality of him, the real world that we will live in forever and ever and ever, that your eyes get open to that. And then we get excited because it's real. It's real. This world is perishing, but that's real. The thing is, it overlaps over us in the Spirit, in Jesus Christ. The kingdom of God has come. And if we want to be aware of that kingdom and walk in that kingdom and the revelation of that kingdom, then there's some things we need to do. We're going to talk about those things a little bit later on. But Jesus, this is his house. This is his living room. It's not your playpen. It's not my playpen. It's not church. It's his living room. It's his house. And he has allowed us to come in his house. He's allowed us to come touched by his presence. He's allowed us to come that he might lay his hands upon us and continue to change our life, and that we might have an encounter with him. And so I hope and pray that you come expecting to have an encounter with him. He's waiting to have an encounter with his people, his ecclesia, his body. He's waiting to saying, does anybody want me to be your head? Does anybody want me to see? He'll only come if we make him the head. He's not going to come to shake your hand. He'll only come. We're his body, and he expects to be the head. He expects to be the one in charge. He expects us to close our mouth and open our ears and open our eyes. He expects to come and be the head. I'm telling you, empty your head so that he can be the head. Let him be God. Let him come and transform you. Give him an invitation to come and do so. Would you bow your hearts with me? Lord, we are exuberant about you coming. We're exuberant and give you an invitation to come and be our head. We give you an invitation to come and stand over us and be our great king. We give you an invitation to come and wash us and cleanse us and forgive us of our trespasses and our immoralities and our hostilities. Lord, things that's going on the TV thing. I don't have TV, and I'm glad I don't. We do watch old movies. We got Netflix, and we watch the 40s and 50s movies and stuff like that, and just absolutely love it. I would give you this counsel. Don't listen to the counsel of the world. Don't eat it, don't drink it, don't smell it, don't sip on it. There's evil in all societies throughout the earth. And whatever the devil does something to try to grab the significance of the media, he gets to pour things into our heart. He gets to pour hate, he gets to pour prejudice, he gets to pour things that are in there because somebody's a fool and wants to do weird things. There's lots of fools. The world is not short of them. There's lots of these things that have gone on since man fell. So let go of it. Get it out of your heart. Did you know I'm not a U.S. citizen? I'm a citizen of the kingdom of God. Now, do I love America? Yes, I do. My citizenship's in heaven. And my mind is supposed to be focused on the heavenlies. My mind is supposed to be focused on what my God is doing in me, what he's doing in you, his people. So substitute those things, and we'll be talking about that a little bit later on in the message, of keeping our eyes upon him and fixed upon him. We will be thrilled as the world goes through all of its torment. We'll be thrilled when we go through parts of the tribulation or when it approaches. Why? Because our God will move closer and closer and closer, and we will behold him more and more and more, and the world will go absolutely mad. But in the midst of it, we will see more of our God. So keep your focus on him. Shall we worship our Lord?
Thank you, Jesus.
For you, 'cause I want to know.
want to experience you just as we would in our own quiet times at home. We want to experience you as a congregation. To hear your voice, to feel your touch, to see you, to know you. That is our highest goal, to know you more. So let us see you this day. Oh, Jesus, make yourself known to us.
Your grace. listen. I want you to be aware that morning by morning by morning, I watch you. I see you awaken. Morning by morning, I cause the sun to rise, and you can perceive and see the darkness fading back until the sun is fully risen. I watch you. How you awaken and what your first thoughts are set the tune for your whole day. If you grumble and complain, oh, I am so tired, I don't want to get up, I want to sleep, or oh, what's going to happen during this day? If you mutter and complain, that's how your day will be. But if you awaken saying, oh Lord, another day you've given me, a day to praise you, a day to walk with you. Lord, this is a day that you have made. Cause me to be glad in it. Cause me to do your will and to walk your way. Then you have set the tone for your day. Know that I know you, that I love you, that I call you to, in the midst of steep, steep paths, to trust me. In the midst of high waters, trust me. In the midst of darkness, trust me. Know that I am yours. Include your faith with your trust. Embrace me day by day, moment by moment, so that you're not surprised by anything, but you're able to have me present and close to you in the midst of everything that happens to you. When hard times come, know that I'm with you, that I will lead you, that I will guide you, that I will take care of you. Be mine from your awakening moment until the time you fall asleep, and know that you sleep in my arms and in my love. Be loved by me and share that love. Be wise in me and share that wisdom. Be mine fully, day by day by day.
I say, I will, Lord. I will be yours today, every day. Oh, help me more into that, Lord. Oh, help me to walk in that, Lord, so that I become your delight, and so that we, your people, become your delight. Help us walk in that, Lord, for we desire that. If you agree, would you say amen?
Amen. Amen.
just worship Him in the Spirit. Brokenness will heal. In me, while there's chaos around, I'm solid. I don't shift back and forth. I'm real. I can speak. And a desire to teach you how to listen and how to speak to me. Don't be frivolous. Don't be an airhead. Listen to me. Don't talk. Listen. Listen for my spirit. Look for my ways. I extend my hand to you. Take my hand. And I can walk you through all the things that you will go through in your life. Do you want to be my little one? Do you want to know me? Not just know about me, but know me. Offer my hand to you.
make confession this morning that we have made you too small. Lord, we have made confession that we believe that there are things that you just can't do. Lord, we have asked you to be magnified. We've asked to see your glory. We've asked to see it pass right before us this morning. Oh, let us know your glory before we leave you. Because we want to know you. We want to know you. We've made you too small in all of these areas. Help us remember. And if we've never known you in any other way, let us know you for what you are, for who you are. Let these days be truly known as days of awe. Just because of what we see happening in the world around us. Because we see you for who you are. When you touch the sky, lightning kisses the ground. When you touch the earth, mercy falls.
When you call. Father, the message that we heard even through the songs was unmistakable. You are ancient, you are endless, you're glorified, you're all-powerful, you are holy. And as long as we stand in the light of your light, and as long as we stand with you and by you, listen to you and hold on to your hand, we will be all right. And I'm amazed by that. And this morning, Lord, we continue our worship, further listening to you by giving you tithes and offerings to further your kingdom, being obedient to your word. And we thank you, O God, that you have set your foot plainly here, and you desire to be the head here. And we thank you so much for that. In your very, very precious name we pray. Amen.
We have several announcements this morning. First of all, there's a sign-up sheet back there for Wednesday night meals, and I think that for Wednesday, we don't have anybody providing a main dish. So if you think you'd be able to do that, then go up there and sign up, especially for Wednesday night. But there's other opportunities to provide a meal for the rest of the month, and it might be a little more difficult with people out on vacation and whatnot. But anyway, if you could consider doing that. Elsewise, we're going to be eating a lot of pizza on Wednesday nights, and so we like that home-cooked meal. Also, I don't know if you noticed the notice on the window going into the kitchen that we are in the process of upgrading a lot of our computer equipment. Some of this has been around for 7 years or more, maybe even more because we bought it used. So it's old technology, and we need to be upgrading all of that stuff for our sound system. If you noticed a few Sundays here, we've had some difficulty. We've finally purchased some computer equipment with the sound card that can handle our sound system. And so that's hopefully will make a big difference in the way things work around here. But that all costs a lot of extra funds. And so I think we're trying to raise around $5,000 to cover all of that. So if you want to consider giving to the electronic fund, just put that on your check in the thing, or tell Carol as you hand her those $1,000 bills, you know, just you pass those to her, and you just say, these are for the sound system and the computer equipment. We're also, the part of that updating is for the radio station too, so that we can handle more listeners. And Frank and Tristan have really been concentrating on that and doing some great things there. And some in the future, there'll be more announcements to make about the radio station. And so we're really looking forward to kind of trying to focus on it more. We haven't been able to do that because of building the church and so forth and so on. So if you could really keep the radio station in prayer, the doors that need to be opened for that, some of the things that we want to do to promote it more, so it's out there on the net more visibly, those kind of things. So please keep the radio station in prayer. I think that the last announcement that I have has to do with the children's ministry. Sherry was not able to be here today because she has to pick up her kids who have been on vacation with her in-laws. But she wanted me to thank you for those of you who signed up to help with the children. She's done a marvelous job in the curriculum and doing the administrative work that to help it flow more easily for those of us who volunteer there. And so thank you for those of you who signed up. It really relieves a lot of work on those who have been doing it for a while. And we appreciate that very much. So I think that she's going to be calling the newbies and kind of going over that with you of what we need, what you signed up for, and how you can best serve in that area. So thank you again. It's a delight to be with the kids. They are amazing children, and to be that involved in their life, and to be able to knit them into the body of Christ, getting to know each and every one of you on a more intimate basis as you serve back there and teach and hold and spank, or, you know, we don't spank them, but, you know, we just put them up on a hook if they're not eating, or not teasing. But anyway, so thank you, though, for signing up.
I think that song is played every time when God opens his books in heaven. I do. It just thrills my heart when I hear that, because it's the stellarness of his voice getting ready to speak to us. And believe it or not, I listen to that song when you're not here, because I want the word to open, and that's what it signifies to me. I heard of a young girl that went to her mom, excuse me, she went to her dad, and she said, "Dad, where'd the human race come from?" And he said, "Well, in the book of Genesis, God made man, he made the earth, and he breathed on man, and man became a living being, and he made Eve, and then all the human race came from that." And she goes, "Wow, that's amazing." And a couple of days later, she goes to her mom, and she, "Mom, where'd the human race come from? What do you think?" I said, "Well, honey, that's easy." Her mom was agnostic. "We, you know, everybody was a bunch of monkeys, and they kind of evolved, and they just went around in trees, and they decided they were going to lose their tails, and they decided they were going to grow taller, and they decided they were going to do this." And she stood there puzzled for a while. And she went back to her dad, and she said, "Dad, I'm confused. Mom says that we came from monkeys, and you say that we came from God." And he said, "Well, honey, you know there are two sides to this family." Now, I'm telling you that because we're trained to get from being monkeys and house apes in God's house to being like God. That's our objective, is to become like him. Now, here's the problem. Here's the problem. Is that we want to do it our way. We want to cut in on God, and he poses the question, but we want to cut in on him and change the question. An example of that, Johnny's sitting in his classroom, typing class, and teacher says, and it was the end of the year, and she says, and she's been asking questions, and people that raised their hand got special things. And then she said, "Class, now this is the most special question you will ever hear. And whoever answers these questions don't have to take the final exam. You get to go home right now. You get an A in your class." And all of a sudden she sees a typewriter fly out the window. And she, "Who threw that typewriter out?" And Johnny said, "I did." Do you get that? We change the question so that we get the right answer. We change the question. Now, the thing is that if we're living without God, I don't know, while I was gone, I actually saw some news, and I thought, oh. We need to turn that off. And once I heard something happened, I just shut it off. I didn't want man's comments in my head. I didn't need man's comments in my head. I don't want men. It's bad enough things that happen, but I don't need some desk jockey house ape telling me what it means and where the world's going. God's the only one that knows where the world's going, and that person behind a microphone don't know God. So why should I be stupid and listen to him? And you got one of these little things, and it's got an off button on it. Don't you wish we could just click it and turn on the channel of heaven? Do you realize God knows everything that's going to take place here on earth? There's nothing that escapes his attention, nothing he doesn't know about. And man's the one doing the bad things, not God. For men always say, what kind of God's that will do that? God's saying, what kind of man's that that would do that? What kind of God that would say that there's no way into heaven and unless it's his way? He said, it's a good God. Do you know where you're going unless I open the door? If Jesus hadn't have come, we would all be cast into the place of dark. Every human being cast away from the living presence of God. And out of his tender mercy, when we could not die to our sin, he came down and took care of that problem. Then he made this statement. Anybody that will follow my son, anybody that will receive him as their king, their savior, anybody that will do what he says, I'll give them admittance into my heaven, although you don't deserve it. I don't know how you can get any better than that. Well, here's the thing. We're going to get off into the word. And before we do that, I think we need to pray, right? Lord, we joyfully come to you this morning and ask you, Lord, for new joys in your presence and fellowship with you. We ask you that your word would come into our heart and that life would come and that your spirit would sing to us so that we're transformed. Bring your word now and help us receive it in Jesus' name. Amen. Now, if you have a tendency to being distracted, tell yourself, don't do that. Listen to what God has to say, and the screen will light up. If you're wondering where Jackie and I have been, that's where we stayed, and right out there in a little mattress in the middle of the... Oh, I love the desert. I love the desert. I was raised part of my life in the desert, and the Sonoran Desert is my favorite. My absolute favorite. Even though there's heat. Now, if you go there in the wintertime, you're going to fall so in love that you're going to say, wow, this is great. For it is absolutely majestic in its greenery. And if you have a itch somewhere, you can back up to a cactus and you can resolve that issue because you'll have so many needles in you won't even feel the itch. The cactus and the greenery is so thick. It's just amazing. Some of those cactus tower 40 feet in the air. And some of the saguaros are 2.5 feet in diameter. And they're not just a piece of flesh standing. They have real wood in them. And the desert is alive. It's absolutely alive. It's full of javelina, full of coyotes, every kind of bird that you can think of, and quail. And when we were there, God gave us a room, had a balcony, and every morning we got to watch the quail. And every evening we got to watch the birds come in. And three times we got to... Our balcony was faced right next door to where they were... Scottsdale was setting off their fireworks. So... Friday night, we got to watch fireworks, and Saturday night, we got to watch fireworks, and Sunday night was a big show, and of course, the 4th was just huge, and then on the 4th, we also got an air show, and they were flying right over a balcony, you know, and I just said, Lord, only you could arrange that, because he told us, don't do much. The last day, you can kind of go around and look a little bit, but be still before me, be still. So, are you still? I guess the question is, how do we get our souls still so that God can speak to us? And what is there in the desert that God wants to bring into our heart? Because you realize without him speaking, our lives are desert. Without him speaking, our lives are desert. No matter how pretty you want to paint it, our lives are desert without water unless he speaks. And if he speaks, he has something to say. You see that cactus praising the Lord? And all its babies are watching. They're learning to praise the Lord. It's a group session. We should understand God's promises in our desert. I had something significant happen while I was gone. I had a dream that the Lord gave me, and it was absolutely overwhelming. Overwhelming. Never seen anything like it. Now, I've shared a little bit with you about the Valley of Mysteries and all that stuff, that dream. In this dream, I was walking on a street, but it was like it was a river. And then I noticed the bride over here, and she had just planted something, and she was making sure she didn't step on anything, and she was making sure nobody stepped on what she planted. It was a garden. She was looking, watching, poised, waiting for something to come out of the ground. And all along the way, I could see that everything had been pruned. Every tree had been pruned, and there was just limbs laying all over the ground. I thought, holy smoke, look at this. And the bride of Christ had taken some of the limbs and put them along the edge of the garden so nobody would step over limbs onto that which had been planted. And I looked and saw all the limbs. And all of a sudden, something began to happen. And it's like there was dew dripping off the remaining trees. Then I walked on past the bride of the Lord, and I saw on this side of me trees. And then a grassy spot appeared. And then there was some limbs that were there that were dead. And then I saw on this side of me, which would look like a street, but it was like a river that you could walk on. On this side of me were these amazing trees. And all of a sudden, where they had been pruned, they shot out new limbs. And then leaves appeared just until they were just full. And fruit appeared. Blossoms appeared. And I've never in my life, and I sense, oh, Lord, you're making everything fruitful. I see as the ground was seething with living water. And I got this vision inside the dream of grabbing a dead branch and running over in that grass and jamming it into the ground. And as I did, it instantly started doing this and became a tree, and it's going up. And the Lord said, hang on to the limb. And I hung on to the limb, and by the time I got up, I was 50 feet, and I'm in the tree. Now, it leaves. It blossoms. It's got fruit hanging off of it. I'm standing on the top of it, and it's like God is saying, proclaim, it's a season of fruitfulness. It's a season of fruitfulness for my people. And so the good question that I think that the Holy Spirit wants to ask us, if he's sending that, how do we prepare for that? If he's sending that, how do we not miss that? Because if I hadn't have stuck the dead branch in the ground, it would not have grown. If I hadn't have recognized, and I began to weep and laugh and, oh God, this is the most marvelous thing. As one of those limbs on the trees on this side, it just, and all these leaves popping out on it and blossoms and then fruit coming on it. I just began to weep and I said, God, I've never seen anything. He said, there are all kinds of seasons, Curtis. There are desert seasons. I use that for killing weed. I use that for making people thirsty. I make thorny things so they can realize they need something that's not thorny. I make it hot so they'll leave their lives, because they build their lives in the midst of that, and they get where they don't care about the heat, and they get where that's the normal thing, They get where they don't need water. They'll bring in their own supply. They'll build there, and they miss me totally in their life. Although they landscape it, it's still nothing but cactus. Nothing but cactus. One lady, when we were there, offered me some prickly pear jelly. It's made out of the fruit of a prickly pear. It's deadly to me. It's pure cysteine. And I produce cysteine kidney stones. And here she's offering me a jar of kidney stones. No, thank you. There's some Gila monsters out there. There's some toads that are deadly out there. Lots of scorpions out there. Does this sound like life? Because what I see the Lord offering to His people, they will stay near the river and stay close to the water, that will allow His pruning, that will take the time to put in a garden. There was two different things there. One was a vegetable garden and the bride of Christ waiting, and I promise you, by the time I walked by, the garden was grown. And it had fruit in it ready to eat. But there was also trees. And you know, it takes trees a long time to make fruit. If God's in the midst of it, we can get God in the midst of it. If we can get on the bank of the river where the living water is, it doesn't take a lifetime to produce fruit. It didn't take an hour to produce fruit. It didn't take 30 minutes to produce fruit. It took less than 30 seconds for that dead limb, and the Lord said, hang on to it, and it became one of the main branches. And He said, now step into the middle of the tree, and the tree went on up. The tree was like humongous. You cut a door through it, drive a car through it. That's fruitfulness. I came away in that dream with absolute ecstatic joy about the future. Ecstatic joy that it's about us and the church and what God wants to offer in these last days is real fruitfulness. So if He's offering real fruitfulness, Isaiah 35, 1 and 2, and the desert shall rejoice and blossom as the rose. It shall blossom abundantly and rejoice. Can you imagine? Who's the desert? Who's the desert? Who's the desert? Do you want to blossom abundantly where you can rejoice? I could not keep from rejoicing when I saw those limbs out of a tree, all of a sudden leaves popping on it like popcorn. It was that quick. And here come the blossoms. And here come the fruit. It shall blossom abundantly and rejoice, even with joy and singing. You need some joy? It comes from fruitfulness with God. There's no other source for it. Joy only comes if we are fruitful in God. There's a command that we're supposed to be fruitful. We're supposed to produce fruit. Did you know that? Isaiah 35, 5 through 7. Then the eyes of the blind shall be open. Now, how many of you get regular glimpses of the heavenlies and the kingdom of God? If you're not looking at it, you're not seeing it, you're blind. The ears of the deaf shall be unstopped. I hear the Lord all the time. We're supposed to hear the Lord all the time. We're not supposed to make decisions without hearing from Him. Then what we hear, we're supposed to get confirmed. But if we're not hearing and we're having to make the decisions, that's desert life. But if we hear, now it's like He causes springs to break forth of the directives that we need, and our ears become unstopped because we can hear Him. Then the lame shall leap like a deer. I meet many lame Christians that can't get in the presence of the Lord. They're dragging themselves with their arms. They can't get in. They're lame. Some of them choose to be lame by our actions. We do things to our spiritual man that disables us from chasing after God. in this season of fruitfulness, God is the one that intervened in the dream that caused those things to take place. Our responsibility is to get the dead things into the good ground and into the water. So we're going to need to look at, if he's going to bring a seed season of fruitfulness, what good would it have done, again I ask you, if I had left the dead branch there? I would have missed season. It was me to take the dead branch and get it in good ground. So we need to identify what good is good ground, where good ground is at, and we need to identify who's a dead branch. It's you. Are y'all in agreement with me? If you're in agreement with me, who's the dead branch? So, let's look and see. For the water shall burst forth in the wilderness, and streams in the desert, and the parched ground shall be a pool. Being raised in the desert southwest, some of the irrigation that they use, they've got a big ditch that runs by, and they make the fields absolutely flat and level, or sometime maybe a half inch higher at one end, 6 blocks away than the other end, and they flood that field with about 3 inches of water. And every 3 days, they flood that field with 3 inches of water. And boy, you talk about causing plants to jump out of the ground. Works far better than a sprinkler system. It doesn't disturb the plants. It gets into the roots and it soaks into the ground. And if you want your bushes to grow, you got to soak them. So God is offering to you a way that a pool can form in your desert if you'll take your dead stick and plant it in the good soil and respond to him, follow his instructions. As a matter of fact, I found, you see that limb sticking out? That was kind of like what it was like in the dream. And just a skinny stick, and all of a sudden it just goes to a tree, and a limb just comes right past me, and it had leaves on it like that. Is that up there? Do you see that? This just shot out right in front of my face. I was like standing right here. It went up, shot out, blossomed, and then it made fruit. And it was that quick. We're going to look at Ezekiel 47:12, along the bank of the river. Where? Location, location, location. On this side and that. Do you get that? Do you know what that means in the Hebrew? Where are we at? We're on this side of the edge of the kingdom of God. There's also another side to where the river's at. And that's in the kingdom of God in the heavenlies. This side and that. Isn't that amazing? This side and that. If it's that close, if we can wade into the river on this side, we can see what's on the other side and the trees that are there. But there's also trees that are forming on this side. That side they're already formed. This side is where they need to form. That's the kingdom of God that Jesus spoke about, that we're supposed to repent and enter the kingdom of God. Repent means change from the direction we're going, and Jesus is the only one that can change us. So we have to come to him and surrender to him as Lord and Master. Lord and Master. He will accept no other position. He's not interested in accepting any other position. He's looking for people that want to be his servants, his slaves, and become his children. And if you don't want to be his servant, and you don't want to be his slave, you can't become his child. You have to be his servant. You have to be his slave. If you do, and you perform your duties in that position, then you can become his child. It's also part of salvation. Did you know that? God crowned him king. And there is not one celestial being that's not frightened to death, that doesn't fall on his face, that cries out for mercy when he walks past. There's not one celestial being that when he enters a part of the heaven and they become aware of it, they fall on their face and they begin to say, glory, glory, glory. Just in response to his presence. How stupid are we? How unknowledgeable are we? God the Father, offers us this same great King that rules the heaven. What should our response be? It should be on our face and thank you, O Jesus, O our great God, for bringing salvation to us. Thank you, we will obey you. Thank you, we won't be immoral. Thank you, O God, we'll stop lying, we'll stop cheating. Thank you, O Jesus. Man has forgotten that. But you will stand before him. And when you stand in heaven, your knees are going to hit the ground. You're going to say, oh my God, I didn't know who you were. When you see the angels that are 10,000 times brighter than us, 10,000 times strength with armor, throw their armor down and fall on their face and grovel before him. And me, little prideful, overweight man, comes up. How you doing, Jesus? I thank you for saving me. I'm saved. And every angel on its face, something's wrong with that picture. Part of our salvation is the fear of the Lord, and we can't have the fear of the Lord unless we understand He's King in heaven and He's King in His kingdom. And if we want to be where the trees are in this kingdom, we have to accept Him as King, because those trees are responsive to the great King. They won't blossom and bloom unless the great King comes. And why would the King come in our midst for some arrogant man thinks he doesn't need God? He's not going to come. The tree's not going to bloom on this side unless he comes. So if we want the trees to bloom on this side, one of the prerequisites is we recognize, oh, you are the great King. Because if he comes, even the trees respond to him. If he comes, even the dead stick responds to him. If he comes, the water that flows out from under the throne comes and brings life. What should our response to be to such a great thing? It should be overwhelming. It should be without guile within us. It should be without, well, I'll just wait and see what happens. They will bear fruit every month because the water flows from the sanctuary. On that side, this side and that, on that side, water flows from the sanctuary. It can come to this side where the dead branches are. It can come to this side because many of those trees were little bitty trees. I could see branches everywhere that had been trimmed. I tell you, the branches that had been trimmed off were bigger than a little stick sticking out of the ground that was a tree. And do you get the implications of that? Many branches that we sprout of our own will, of our own purposes, and God wants to cut those off. Quick, quick. Now the real tree can grow. Revelation also bears this out. Then he showed me a river of water of life, clear as crystal, coming from the throne of God and of the Lamb. Where's it coming from? The throne of God and the Lamb. When do you think the Lamb showed up slain on the throne? This is just a freebie. You realize that's the state that he was in. He was crushed. He was brutalized. He was bleeding. He had just died, and his blood everywhere. He's a bloodied mess. Before he got up on the throne, you know what he did? He went in and laid his body. His altar had to be sprinkled with his blood. Then he came back, and he sat on the throne. That's why we get this appearance of the bloodied lamb, the broken lamb. He's the high priest also, and he had to take the blood in to atone for everything that took place here on earth. Then he took his rightful place on the throne, because he's king too. He's the only one that's king and priest. He's the only one that ever be king and priest. On either side of the river was a tree of life. You realize, I saw one time in a dream, I crested this set of great falls, took me several weeks to climb, and I saw in the Garden of Eden in this tree, it was probably a mile, maybe 2 miles wide, and its roots reached both sides of the banks. And it was maybe underneath, between the river and its root system, it was probably 1,000 feet. And then it went up from there. Now, don't count that as scripture. I'm just telling you what I saw in a dream. It was absolutely amazing to behold. There are so many amazing things. We will be entertained for the rest of our life. And you know, I can just see us. We get there and we go, woo, and we look this way, whoa, and wow, oh, it's just going to be heaven full of those noises when we arrive. And either side of the river was the tree of life bearing 12 kinds of fruit. There are different kinds of fruit. We need fruit to heal our soul. We need fruit to heal our spiritual man. We need fruit to heal our untruthfulness, our connivingness. We need fruit that will heal our desire to withdraw and be alone. You need some fruit to heal you so you're not a loner. God didn't make the bride of Christ to be alone. He expects all the parts to be together. And if we can get the parts together, then the head comes. If the head comes, then we get some direction for our lives individually. Why? Because now the head begins to orchestrate all the parts. So yielding fruit every month, 12 kinds of fruit every month. The leaves of the tree were for the healing of the nations. That nations is also the Gentiles. Are you a Gentile? You're not a Jew, you're a Gentile. There are only two classes of people. There's the Jews that had a covenant and contract with God. And we were a subgrade people that had no covenant nor contract with God. And Jesus, a Jew, engrafted us in to that equation and made a whole new covenant with us. They're under the law. If they want their Yoshia HaMashiach, then they have to receive their Yoshia HaMashiach. And when they do, then the Spirit is available for them, and they will be a completed Jew that now has two covenants. Two covenants. One covenant is for the land. The other covenant is that God would be their God, and He would walk amongst them, forgiven, righteousness coming through Jesus, their Messiah. Now us, He didn't promise us the land. He did give us access in that we might know Him. He did give us access in that we might see Him and behold Him. Only time I'm changed is when I catch little glimpses of Him. And in this dream, I caught some major glimpses of Him. In the process, it woke me up and it brought some healing in some areas. So, where can we bloom? I think that's a reasonable question to ask, right? If He wants to bring this, where is that? Is he gonna bring it on the streets of Dallas and all that weird stuff going on? Or does He have a specific location that He's going to do that? Location, location, location. Those who are planted in the house of the Lord shall flourish in the courts of our God. Remember the kingdom of God? We're on this side. He's on that side. The river's in between. Life is stretching out to us. Where's the life coming from? Jesus. Jesus, all life comes from Him. He said He is the way, the truth, and what? So all life comes from Him. So His roots are reaching across the river. Who is the water of life? Jesus is. Did you realize when the ark had been made, when it finally arrived, it was missing two things inside? Did you know that? When it finally arrived in Jerusalem, it was missing two things. It was missing the golden pot of manna, and it was missing the rod of Aaron that budded and produced. What did the rod of Aaron do overnight? Produced leaves, blossomed, and almonds. It's a whole bag of almonds there. Those two things were missing. Why? Because Jesus is the manna. And he reserved that we might eat of him. Remember in the Lord's Supper when he said, this is my body. And he said, I am the bread of life. All who eat of me will live. So he reserved himself, and what was he in? He's in a golden pot. And then the rod showed us that he took that out. Why? Because he carried it, that he can bring us life. That was the symbol that was given for Israel to know who was in charge, was it not? There was a big argument, who's in charge? We're going to put somebody else in charge. We're not so sure Aaron should be in charge. We're not sure Moses should be in charge. So what miracle did God do? He said, bring me Aaron's rod. Jesus is the leader of the high priesthood, and so he's got the rod that can bring the life, but the life is in him, and he's the one that gives life to the rod. And in the dream, Jesus was the one doing all these things. I could sense him all around. The water was oozing up out of the ground. And I'm thinking, how am I walking on this pathway that's a river, that's a road? Realize the path that Jesus has for us is also a road. But what's inside the courts of our God? It is not his throne inside the courts? And what comes out from under the throne? River of life. So those who are planted in the house of the Lord, this is one of his houses. This is not a church. This is not a social organization. We play music for the Lord, worship for the Lord. Praises and prayers go up to him 24/7 when this place is not occupied. We don't allow anything unholy to come in there. And that which comes in, we actually pray, and Lord, would you call it something holy? Do you realize in the tabernacle, all the articles were holy in there? And it says if one of those holy articles touches something unholy, the holy article doesn't become unholy. Instead, it makes that thing which is unholy, holy. You realize we got holy carpet in here. We got holy air in here. And if you're contaminated, we got holy chairs. If you're unholy, we got holy chairs. There's something holy touching you. So when you come into the house of God, something is touching us that came from him, has been dedicated to him, gone through the ritual process of anointing it. There's scriptures behind every peep, all the paint in this room. There's scriptures written on the floor. There's scriptures on the ceilings, on the back sides of the tiles. And those tiles that got painted, there's scripture on those. This is his house. This is his holy place. And as his house, if you will just get planted, there's the only place the good ground is. I meet lots of people that are loners and goats. My house is holy. I don't have to go to church. I don't need to go do it God's way. There's a typewriter out the window. If you got that joke. But where are we going to flourish? In the courts of the Lord. That's why we work so hard and have people come and pray over the place. I went to Grace Chapel there in Scottsdale. Richard and I used to play golf, I don't know, 38 years ago and all that good stuff. And I just absolutely loved it. They had a foyer that was probably twice as long as our sanctuary with all these tables in it. And one of those tables, there were several, all the tables, there was no place to sit. All the tables were taken. There was one table that had about 10 ladies at probably 75 to 90. And boy, they got their hands locked together and they're, oh God, move. Bring your spirit. Oh Lord, anoint us this day. And sanctify the ground that when we come on it, that we can be, that they're just going after it. And I'm thinking, yes, oh dear God, we need that. We do have people come and walk the mall. We need more. We need people to walk the parking lot. We need people to pray. God moves when we pray. Especially when we pray, would you sanctify the ground? Why do we need the ground sanctified and made holy? We're spiritual lepers. Lepers, you know. What's a leper supposed to do? Unclean! Run, unclean! Many of our attitudes, our hostilities towards life, our angers, our frustrations. We should cry unclean. If we can just drag that unclean body here and be in His presence, He can heal our uncleanness. He can heal the spiritual leprosy that we have where we can't see Him and hear Him. He can heal the parts that don't work. But other seed fell on good ground and yielded a crop, some 100, some 60, and some 30. None of the other conditions of ground, the rocky ground, the busy road where somebody planted themselves in the pathway, none of those produced fruit. The seed that was sown in with the tares, that was people's desires for life and what they wanted to do, trying to mix, serving a living God, that is King, and saying, I got some other things to do. I'll be back at 4. If you're here, I only have about 45 minutes when I come. Thorns. We need to get into the good ground. I could see all around me water rushing in the dream. I found this. He who believes in me, as the scripture said, from his innermost being will flow rivers of living water. Because while I was walking along in the midst of that, something was happening in me too. I was believing God more and more. I believed Him enough that I could pick up a dead stick and go stick it in the ground. I believed Him enough that, Lord, You're doing. I wept because He was doing. I wept, oh, God, You're moving. You're moving. Ever since I moved here, I prayed, God, would You pour out revival upon us? Would You move? Would You move upon us? To sit and just listen to sermons doesn't do anything unless He anoints it with His Spirit and with His heart and with His mind and with His presence, with His knowledge. As He extends His hands, man cannot change. And my heart groans because I have been in my lifetime, I have been involved in 3 great revivals of seeing thousands upon thousands upon thousands of people, cross-denominational, coming to the Lord. Half of them unsaved, most of them not filled with the Spirit, and God made us a common bond of filling us with the Spirit, walking in peace with each other. No craziness, no weirdness like you see today. Genuineness of love. And it was cross-denominational. How can that be? Worshiping next to me is a Catholic. Next to me over here is an Episcopal, and then a Baptist, and we're all singing to the Lord and worshiping in the Lord, and His presence was there. And I saw this take place, God pouring out His water. But it took a great cry from the people of, oh God, we are so thirsty. Galatians 5:22, but the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, kindness, goodness, and faithfulness. These trees were loaded with that fruit. God wants you to produce this fruit. And if you're not producing this fruit, you're not faithful to Him to be in His house, you're not faithful to Him to be with His people, if you're not faithful to Him to read His Word, you're not faithful to Him to be on your face in prayer, need visitation of the water from the Spirit so that we can become faithful. That's one of the fruits of the Spirit. Joy, if you're lacking in joy, the only way, the only access there is to joy is through the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit is the one that brings joy. Holy Spirit has to anoint you with joy. If you get in the Holy Spirit's presence, you'll have visitations and revelations of Jesus. His Word will be open to you, and when you read His Word, something will spark in your heart until you burst with joy. You cannot keep from it. So, again, we must identify what the fruit looks like. Does it say the fruit is getting a bigger house? Does it say that fruit is getting a better job? Does it say that fruit is having more money in your bank? Be Because I know there are some of our tribes out there that says that's fruit. That's not fruit of the Spirit. That's greediness and stinginess. Instead, look at your list and keep that in your heart, for that is the identifier of the fruit. We must identify if God wants to bring fruitfulness, this is what He wants to bring. For you were once in darkness, but now you're in light in the Lord. How are we in light? If we're in the Lord. Walk as children of the light, for the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness. Now, if you want to get all sour and all that stuff, you just poured acid on good ground. If you want to get all bitter, you just poured acid on good ground. If you want to become angry, you just poured acid on good ground. Children of the light, the fruit of the Spirit is in all goodness. So if God has given you a good ground that can produce fruit, keep your anger out of it. Anger comes because we don't get our way. That's a spoiled child. You need a pacifier, one of those sucky things to stick in your mouth. Oh, don't get my way. You're not doing what I want you to do. Well, grow up. Other people are not supposed to do what you want them to do. You're supposed to do what God wants you to do. And it's not your concern whether the other person is doing what you think they should do towards God. And you're not their judge to judge whether they're doing right before God. You're supposed to have your eyes on Jesus and be obedient to Him and praying, diligently praying. Instead, the enemy comes and says, well, they're just condemned to hell. They're not part of God. They couldn't be saved. That's all the enemy. And everything don't go our way. We're like spoiled children. And we begin to condemn part of the bride of Christ. And Christ is the one that died for that other part. Christ is the one that paid the penalty. Now you're going to say His penalty wasn't enough. His penalty doesn't cover. Another thing of the Spirit, that the fruit, it's produced in goodness and righteousness. Righteousness comes when the Holy Spirit begins to direct us. And we say, yes, Lord. Now, the Holy Spirit's going to direct you first into Scripture. Why? So you can learn what the Spirit's voice sounds like. And everything the Spirit has to say, we put the big magnifying glass, the electron microscope over what we think He said, and we take it apart to see if it matches Scripture. If it doesn't match Scripture, stop right there. Doesn't match what God does and who He says He is, stop. Because it's you or it's the enemy. It has to match what's there. Two pieces of the puzzle fit together and they're intricate edges of this puzzle. And if they don't fit, throw that away. It's your opinion. Or you've been taught wrong. Or you've formed wrong theology. Or you have wrong intentions towards God, that you can extract what you want out of Him and you can direct Him to do what you want. God's here, not here to serve you. He put you here to give you an opportunity to serve Him. His kingdom is open for volunteers to serve Him. Jesus did His service to His Father and He came down here. Now, let's look at three things not to do in order to be fruitful. If we're going to be fruitful, there's three things that we can't do. And most Christians I meet do these three things. And they negate the fruitfulness. If God's going to pour out something in the Spirit, if He's going to bring us where we can stand in the kingdom, there's three things that we're not supposed to do if He's going to allow us to stand on this side of the river. Pretty reasonable. Now, how many remember this Danger Will Robinson? Yeah. You're old. it was a show that was called Lost in Space, and there was a young kid in it named Will Robinson, and of course there was a robot in there, and he would come up with his arm, danger, Will Robinson, danger. Well, the Holy Spirit is saying, danger. If God's going to revive us and make us fruitful, three things we don't want to do. Going to Psalms chapter 1, beginning in verse 1. Blessed is the man who walks not in the counsel of the ungodly, number 1. Nor stands in the path of the sinners, number 2. Nor sits in the seat of the scornful, number 3. And we're going to dissect those just a little bit. Blessed is the man. We need to know what blessed is. Blessed is a Hebrew word, eser, which it's an exclamatory word. It's like the Spirit is just trying to express something to us, to explain. It's something from the Spirit being declared to us about the blissfulness of God coming to you, coming to your house. Blissfulness from God, which is frequently connected with wisdom. Isn't that structure? This word is directly, when it says, blessed is the man, it's directly connected also to the wisdom of God, which we have to invoke and act upon the wisdom for that blessing to happen. But it's first declared. Just like, what did the angel say to Mary? Hail, O favored one of God! He was saying, blessed. Oh, you're blessed. You're highly esteemed. He was exploding with excitement. All the angels were standing on their seat. They'd been looking for thousands of years for a woman worthy enough to bring forth the Messiah. She's the first one. She's the first one. You know how significant that is. Thousands of years. Not one woman was worthy to carry the Messiah. Now she steps forward. God makes decisions. She's worthy enough to bring forth the seed. Pause and let you think about that. This blessed is connected to wisdom all through the book of Psalms and Proverbs. The term is also used to describe a person who enjoys a relationship through the Holy Spirit with God in Jesus Christ. Did you realize that's how it works? Jesus came to help us back into the kingdom so we could have a Father. The Holy Spirit came to help us maintain ourselves and our character and our nature in Jesus and in His presence. If we're in Jesus, where's Jesus at? He sits on the throne next to His Father. So we get to fellowship with, through the Spirit, in Jesus, with our Father. Now, how many of you have thanked Jesus for saving you? How many of you have looked over to the Father and said, oh, thank you. Thank you for the Son. Thank you for the Son. That should be our earnest response. Thanking our Father for sending the Son. Proverbs 8 and 32. Now therefore listen to me, my children, for blessed are those who keep my ways, hear my instruction, and be wise, and do not disdain. Disdain means that, oh, well, yeah, I heard you say that, it's fine. Disdain is, well, I know I'm not supposed to do that, but you know these other circumstances, and certainly God will understand. No, if He said something, He meant something, and if we choose something else, we've disdained His instructions. Blessed is a man who listens to me, watching daily at my gate, waiting at the post of my doors. Whoever finds me finds life and obtains favor from God. Whoever finds me? We're supposed to find Him. We're supposed to be at His doors, His gates, every day. Every day, not just when things are hard. And something else about this, there's an obtaining of favor from God that's absolutely amazing. When you obtain His favor, did you know He can do your business for you? If you get out of your business and let God do your business, He can do your business for you. By the way, how's that going, you doing your business for you? Walks not in the counsel of the ungodly. Number 1, it's in red for a reason. What is the counsel of the ungodly? Anything that doesn't have God in it is un. And do you realize there's these psychobabblers that are given counsel? There's financial advisors that don't know God. They're not getting their information or thought process from God. They're getting it from, well, okay, the market does this and this and this, and the pattern I'm getting and perceiving in my mind because of that pattern, this is going to happen. And is that counsel from God? Oh, but they got a track record. 13 years straight, they did this. Is that counsel from God? We jump on the banana boat, even though it's sinking, and think, oh my goodness, they got counsel. Well, he says, we're blessed if we don't walk in the counsel of the ungodly. Let's look at that ungodly. The word indicates people who are enemies of God. Do you realize if you're not for God and obedient and belong in His kingdom, you're His enemy? There's no in-between. There's no gray area. Either you're enemy of God, and if you're enemy of God, you're also enemies of His instructions. People who are enemies of God hate His instructions. And they may be nice about it. And like one pastor told me the other day, I said, well, you know, the Lord revealed this, and this happened. And, well, that's fine, but I don't believe God speaks, and I don't believe in revelation. And you're a pastor. And you have sheep. You're dead if you don't believe God can't do these things. And you have sheep you're responsible for, leading them into death. How can you do that? How can you say God doesn't speak and that He didn't do anything in His Word, and it's just a social program, and it's just head knowledge, and it's just a religion? It's people who do not conform to His purposes. Rasha in Hebrew. I think that's where we get the word rash from. I'm serious. If someone is rash, they're being referred to that you're not following God's instructions. It's people who don't conform to His purposes. It's people who don't conform to His standards. It's people who don't conform to His values. So let's look in the Hebrew. Tzedek in the Hebrew is the opposite. We have to look at the opposite so we can get a full understanding what Rasha means. Because Rasha is a definition of the ungodly. Let's look at the definition, the Hebrew definition of godly. Tzedek. Someone considered to be just or righteous before God because of their conformity to His given standards. You get that? So anyone who does not conform to His standards is Rasha. Are you receiving any counsel in your life about the decisions that you will make for your future? Or how about some of the decisions of your life that you made in the past? Because you go get with the psychobabbler, he's going, oh, well, it was all your mother's fault. It was because you believed in God. You know, you need to get off of that. So you don't need to talk and receive counsel from some fool that doesn't know God about your past. And you don't need to talk to somebody that's a fool that knows nothing about your future. Only God knows your future. And I'll repeat it. You've heard me say it again. I know you think this about me. What am I practicing if I say that? What are you supposed to ask me? Did you see that in your crystal ball? Because you just heard from Satan. Satan is the one telling you what they think. And if you think you think you know what they're thinking, then your thinking is stinking thinking from the enemy. It's not from God. It didn't have any peaceful fruit in it, because I promise you, you don't think, well, that person just thinks I'm wonderful. Have you ever heard that voice? No. It's always the voice of, well, they think less of you. They think you're this and they think that. And who's talking? The enemy is. That's him. We got to identify that. So we must be this person. If we're going to live on the banks of this river and get into the fruitfulness, we have to be someone considered to be just or righteous before God. Why are we just or righteous before God? Because we're going to listen to Jesus and do what he says. If a person says, Jesus, I'll take you as my Savior, but I'm not going to do what you say. Is there a problem in River City?
Oh, yeah.
There is. Now, I'm glad I don't have to work out that equation. But in my life, I can never remember saying, I'll take you as my Savior, but I'm not going to do what you say. My life has always been, I will do what you say. Will you please take me as your slave? Will you please let me serve you? Will you please let me give you my time? You gave me yours. You gave me 33 years of it and then a crummy death. 33 years. He did his part. So, Job, with him are wisdom and might, and to him belong counsel and understanding. So, if he's the one that has counsel and understanding, no wonder he makes the statement that we're not supposed to accept the counsel of the ungodly. So, if we want those limbs, blossoms, if we want fruitfulness, we've got to get away from receiving counsel of the ungodly. Yeah, I stopped watching news because I was receiving counsel of the ungodly. I'm thinking, can't you just give me the facts without your opinion? No, they can't. The object of the news is give you their opinion and to spin the facts. Just give me the facts, okay? These people died. I know what to pray about. I don't need your insinuations. I don't need your fuzziness. I don't need your spin. So I stopped listening to it. Why? Because I realized it was giving me some counsel. And I don't need ungodly counsel. James 3:17. The wisdom that is from above. Do you realize, what's the Holy Spirit, one of his names? Spirit of wisdom and spirit of counsel. Right? So the wisdom that is from above is first of all pure, then peaceable, then gentle, and willing to yield, full of mercy and good fruits, without partiality, without hypocrisy. Now the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace by those making peace. Now I know a lot of do-gooders, social persons that, oh, I'm just supposed to make peace. Oh, it's okay that you killed that person. It's okay that you went and robbed that bank. I just want to make peace. That's not what the word means. It's not you trying to cover over everything and say everything is okay. This is a word from our God. Erin is the word. It's arising from the deepest reconciliation to God. What did the passage have to say? Wisdom of above. Now the fruit of righteousness is sown in peace. What do we need to be in Jesus' presence? He comes, if I accept him as my king, he brings righteousness. Now, I'm expected to respond and live in righteousness. If I'm obedient to him through the Spirit, everything I do is going to be counted as righteousness, right? So he's the one first cleaned the vessel. I'm the one that's supposed to put something in it. Excuse me. So let's look at this. A state of being overwhelmingly connected with God, accompanied with a sense of his presence and a bestowing of his divine favor. Can we read the bottom of that again? Now the fruit of righteousness is sown with an overwhelmingly presence of God and him bestowing his favor upon you. Is there a little bit different meaning in your head there? God wants to put that. The net dream that I had of those branches, it was him overwhelmingly showing himself, him doing things that were beyond my comprehension. I just wept. I said, oh, God, this is so amazing. So amazing. You're amazing. I just stumbled around and just weeping and saying, you're amazing. These things I have spoken to you so that in me you may have that overwhelmingly revelational presence of your Father and feel my blessing come upon you. That I've spoken these things. Now, that poses another question. What things? If he spoke some things that are supposed to get us in that position, what are those things? Why do we walk past the real answers? The real answer, what's the thing? And you'll find that in your Bible. Mm-hmm. But you'll also find it as you walk in the Spirit that the Lord can speak to you too. Nor stand in the path of sinners. That word Hebrew in the Hebrew is hata. It's used to describe those who by their actions are under the wrath and judgment of God. I've met many Christians, by their actions, they show that they are under the wrath and judgment of God. And, oh, no, we're not. You're not supposed to judge me that I'm under judgment. But you got a heroin needle in your arm. What do you mean I'm not supposed to judge whether you're under the wrath of God? You don't know him, or you'd be free. You haven't made him king because your heroin is your king, and you're your king that's got to have the heroin. You're your king that's got to have the meth because you want it. If you wanted God as much as you wanted the meth, then you would be set free. But you want to satisfy yourself with a super pacifier. One is about that big. And plug it in your arm. Your arm goes, I got to have that. Our soul is supposed to be enriched with the presence of God that we desire him that much. So, if we're not going to stand in the path of sinners, and you notice it says stand in the paths of sinners. It didn't say that you're doing what the sinners do. I remind you of Lot that pitched his tent towards Sodom and Gomorrah, and it said because he pitched his tent, he would watch everything. He's a righteous man. Yeah. Well, I don't want to do that, but wow, did you see that? Wow, look at that girl. Did you see the two guys, what they're doing? Oh my goodness. Scripture says that he became vexed in his soul, and he couldn't speak right anymore. Half of his words were curse words as a result of his vexed in his speech. Just for looking. I find so many Christians that look at the path of the sinner, the latest trend on the internet, the latest clothes to wear, the latest flash, how short you can wear your skirts. And that could be even for guys. The weirdness that's out there, none of that is of God. None of that's of God. Now, why am I saying that? Is because if you stand in the path of sinners and you're looking at those things, it's going to vex you in your soul and you're not going to get the fruitfulness. You got to come away from those things. We showed a little clip of a girl who's 13, Deborah, 13, on fire for God or something like that. And the reporter was there. Have you ever read a magazine like this? No. You know who these movie stars are? No. They showed some really wicked people, weird dress. And, oh, no, I don't look at stuff like that. You made a decision that she didn't want that in her soul. And our young people, do you know why they're so wacko? It's because they look at everything that takes place. They're standing in the path of the sinners saying, I'm a Christian, but I'm not going to participate. Well, I tell you what, if you stand in that path long enough, you won't be able to keep from participating. Because it will do something in your soul and you'll be drug out into it. So don't stand in the path. Now for us older folks, our path of a sinner. Sinner didn't pay too much attention to God. Sinner got his own time schedule. A sinner, religious sinner, is one that, I see some change in the plate. There's all kinds of sinners. And if we're standing in a path watching them who don't do such, it's going to affect your soul to where you're not going to be pleasing to God. And you can't get into the fruitfulness. Let's go on here. I know we're going a little bit. Wow, we're going real long, aren't we? Thank you for your time. You want to finish this? Raise your hand. Got two that want to finish it. Raise your hand. Raise your hand if you don't want to finish it. Nobody raised their hand. Oh, come on. Get some backbone. Okay, we're, nor sits in the seat of the scornful. Scornful means to deride or boast so as to express or utter contempt. I know many Christians that anything good that you talk about, that you, okay, you're not supposed to sleep around. Oh, man, Jesus forgave me of sin. It didn't matter. You're scorning at Jesus. He says, shut your mouth and stop arguing. He says, shut your mouth and stop having fights with your husband and with your wife. Oh, but, hey, I don't take it to bed with me. He said stop doing it. And if you don't stop doing it and you come up with a different reason and you give him a different thing, you have scorned at what he gave you instructions to do. When you make plans other than him, you're scorning him. God is supposed to be... What's the number one command? Love the Lord your God with all your heart, mind, soul, and body. I'll get back to you, Lord, because I love this over here too. We scorn him when we walk away. We scorn him when we plan. Why isn't God in the middle of all of our plans? I wouldn't have gone to Arizona. My first question is when that came up, and Lord, are you going down there? Because if you're not going, I'm not. Then why do you want me to go down there? Meet with your wife and with me. That's where I'm going. You going with me, Curtis? Yeah, sign me up. I said, it's 108. He said, no, it's 110. The activity of the scornful is condemned as an abomination. We're not supposed to sit in the seat scorning the things of God, scorning mankind, scorning the Word. Why'd you let that kid die, oh God? We're scorning at him. Why don't you raise up a different government over there in Libya? Why don't you do something in... He has his plan. These are the end times, I remind you. And there will be wars, and there will be rumors of wars, and it's not his fault. That's what man does. Let's go on here. But his delight is in the law of the Lord. And I remind you, there was a substitute of this for us, the Gentiles and the Jews. Anybody remember where it's at? Romans chapter 7? We're no longer under the law of sin and death, but we're under the law of the Spirit and life in Christ. We were transferred under a new law. And so when he's talking about the law now is the law of the Spirit and life. And so, but his delight is in the law, and I'll fill in the blank, of the Spirit and life of the Lord. And in his law of the Spirit of life in the Lord, he meditates day and night. Go back here a second. But his delight, do you delight to get in a position where the Holy Spirit can lead you? If you can delight to get in that position just to be led in the common things in your life, just delight in him. Oh, yes, Lord. Okay, you want me to go to Arizona? Okay, Lord. See, I didn't give a consideration of the cost. I didn't give, we did have to buy tickets and had lots of incidental expenses. Our place was free. I did not take, once the Lord said that's where I'm going, it doesn't matter how much it cost. I'm going. I'll sell everything but my wife, but I'm going. Why? Because that's where he's going. He shall be like a tree planted beside the rivers of water. You remember the dream I had? It was a tree that brings forth fruit in its seasons, whose leaf also shall not wither. Now here's the thing about blossoming and blooming. Okay, wonder how long it will last. Here it says, if you blossom and bloom in the presence of the Lord, it will last. It's forever. whose leaf will not wither, and who, whatever he does, prospers. Now, I know a lot of my name it and claim it people really grab the end of that verse, but they haven't stopped doing the first three things that said don't do these things. They're not planted beside the rivers of water. Where's the river at? It comes out from under the throne. You're not going to get close to the throne unless you make him king. If you make him king, then you can get close to the river.